Welcome to worship at Vavenby Church. Good to have you all here. Jesus, speaking to his disciples, once said, "If you then, though you are evil," of course, he was speaking in comparison to God, "know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him?" Father, lead us in prayer.
O Lord, there is no one like you, and there is no God but you. Your sons and daughters are gathered here in your sanctuary to worship you. In the stillness that comes from waiting silently in your presence, we quiet our troubled hearts. Please, dear Lord, fill us with your presence in this sacred sanctuary. O Lord of grace and mercy, in your great love, help us to be renewed and to worship you and be strengthened in the power of your Holy Spirit. We pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
I've heard Thank you.
God, our Lord and Master, Adonai, Lord of hosts, we have come today to worship you. That's what we're doing, to wait upon you, and that's what we're doing as well. Lord, we know we need to wait because we need you to be glorified in our lives, and we need to have our strength renewed, and we thank you for your promise that we've just sung about, straight from your word, that as we wait upon you, we will be lifted up on wings like eagles. So that we might continue to be your faithful witnesses in this world of trouble and distress. So that we might have strength to deal with the troubles and distresses that are in our own lives and be a witness of what God can do when he walks alongside, when we allow you to walk alongside us. So everlasting Father who reigns forever, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, may you continue to be praised in our midst today. Amen.
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 As long as I can remember what it's called, from Matthew. Matthew 5, starting in verse 21, it says, "You have heard that it was said to those of old, 'You shall not murder, and whoever murders will be liable to judgment.' But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council, and whoever says, 'You fool,' will be liable to the hell of fire. So if you are offering your gift at the altar and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you are going with him to court, lest your accuser hand you over to the judge, and the judge to the guard, and you be put in prison. Truly I say to you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny." So this goes contrary to what I grew up with in the church that I went to before, because this would have been instruction before you take communion, that you'd have to be right with God in every way, and like where the church I went to, you had to confess your sins to a priest, and then you were able to take communion. But there was never any doubt in that church that your offering was accepted no matter what. And that seems to be the wrong attitude, because what I take from this really is that if we're giving our offering, but we're not right with God in all the other areas of our life, then the offering doesn't have the power and the meaning that it should have. It's not as acceptable if we're just not thinking about what we're giving, just not considering the sacrifice that we're making or the thankfulness we should have to our Creator when we're doing that. And so then it doesn't have the meaning it's supposed to have, because offering is supposed to be an act of worship, just like singing here or praying. All of those things are acts of worship. Whatever we do in the name of the Lord is an act of worship. What we do and we call ourselves Christian, everything we do should be an act of worship and not go against what God would have us do. And so in this instance, when he's talking about what you bring to the altar, what you bring as an offering, needs to be considered before you bring it. You need to be asking God, is this what I should bring? Is this the right amount? Am I following what you would have me do? And then it becomes powerful, and then God can take that. And no matter how small you're able to give, God can expand it to do whatever his will is with it. And you'll see that a lot of places where there's not a lot of income in a church, there's a lot of things going on, and that's why, because people are focused on being in God's will when they give. Let's pray. Father, thank you for all you do for us. Thank you that you give us instructions for life that are only benefit us, that they're not counter to anything that you'd have us do. And so, Lord, give us the strength to follow in your ways, be obedient to what you are asking us to do, and then return to your kingdom what you desire of us. Pray your hand of blessing be on the tithes and offerings this morning, and that they can accomplish your purposes in the kingdom work that they're sent to. Ask this in Jesus' name.
A lot of work, Hannah. And I want to say how much I appreciate the children. It doesn't matter how much of a distraction they are. They eventually will become adults. Then we've got to deal with them as adults. And then they got to deal with us. Yeah, I'll tell you something. Good to be here this morning. Glad to see you all today. May God bless you. May your heart be encouraged. May we be encouragers one for each other. And may we be reminded, pray for one another. We're a small enough church where we can remember each other. We can pray for each other regularly. And I believe that's God's call on our heart and bring encouragement to each one of us as we go through life. I'm talking today about who is your ally. Who do you go through the storms of life with? Who is the one who helps you? But before I go into that, I got to say I got a call. Yesterday afternoon, I was busy at my desk like every good pastor should be. On a Saturday afternoon, he should be engrossed in how he's polishing. You know how you polish up a sermon? You go over with a rag and clean everything all up. That's how you polish up with floor polish. That's how you get a shiny sermon. While I was doing that, I get this phone call, and I don't usually answer phone calls when I'm doing that, but I answered it. And it was this guy said, you have won $19.5 million plus a brand new Mercedes Benz. Well, I said, I don't believe you. And he said, why don't you believe you? Why don't you believe me? And then I hung up. I got to thinking, what if it was real? What if I really could have won that money? Then we all would have been rich. And I would have let you drive my Mercedes Benz. Once in a while. But anyway, I didn't, because I thought the news was ridiculous. And it was too good a news to be true, because I've never played a lottery. I wouldn't know how to buy a lottery ticket if I tried. But I wouldn't be opposed to receiving millions of dollars. It wouldn't be against that. It wouldn't go against my theology. Like this guy said, you already got $19.5 million. I could do that. I could receive that. But anyway, so I'll never actually know for sure. But I got thinking, you know, that's our biggest obstacle with the gospel. We don't believe it. We don't believe in the Jesus that gives the gospel, that is the gospel, because it's just too unbelievable to believe. And I think we should kind of be sympathetic with that. If someone has never heard, and they're receiving some message of Jesus that they've never heard of before, we need to be a little bit understanding about how it sounds to them. This just seems too unbelievable. But sometimes the unbelievable becomes very believable. And we speak of the gospel of Christ as a believable gospel. Because the long and short of it, what's unbelievable is that we are here. Did you know the reason there is life on this planet? Did you hear about that in the news? An asteroid came 365 million years ago, came in and hit the Earth. That brought life. Didn't you know that? I didn't notice that in the Bible, but that's what they said, and that's what they think. I think it's a lot more than that, don't you think, than life, than an asteroid hitting the Earth? But we go through life with struggles. We go through life with storms. Life is never clear sailing. I wish it was. Man, I just wish that I could just become a Christian and just, that's it. Everything's good. It never was intended to work that way. sailors that spend their life on the sea are going to and have experienced terrible storms on the sea. I never saw the movie, The Perfect Storm. Did some of you watch that movie? I heard it was a sicko movie, so I didn't watch it. Everybody dies. Anyway, a supposed true story. Nobody knows the truth because nobody survived. But that was a storm that had a bad end. And some storms have a bad end. But there's no question. If you were to talk to a sea captain that it, or any sailor on an ocean liner, and you find out they've never been in a storm, I don't know if I'd want to sail with them. They may not know how to handle the ship if there was a storm. Anyway, you get the point. We go to Matthew 8 and Mark chapter 4. We have the story of Jesus in a boat with his disciples, crossing over to the other side of the large lake. They call it a sea, and a storm hits. You know the story pretty well, told in those two gospels. And so the disciples who were raised on the sea, half of them, more than half of them were fishermen. They knew about water, they knew about boats, but the waves, it says, were coming into the boat and filling the boat with waves, and they became fearful. They were seamen, but they were fearful. But the thing is, Jesus was in the boat. They forgot he was in the boat, apparently. Finally, at the edge of capsizing, one of the disciples had a brainwave. I know, let's wake Jesus. He's napping. And so they go down and wake him up, and here's what they said. Master, don't you care that we're perishing? Don't you realize we're going to drown? And Jesus, what? Why are you so afraid? Why are we so afraid? I'm talking from me, not from the Bible. I'm saying, if I was there, I'd be afraid because I'm thinking I'm going to drown. But see, Jesus gets up, stands up, and what does he say? He doesn't talk to the disciples anymore. He talks to the sea. He talks to the wind. He talks to the storm. And he says, peace, be still. And the wind stopped, and the storm calmed, and the boat began to float securely. Sometimes we forget that Jesus is in the boat of our life. We can look at all kinds of other people. We can look to the government. We can. We don't often anymore. We can look for help from this agency or from this person, and we forget to ask Jesus if he would stand up and calm the waves in our life. I've coined this phrase from Rick Warren, pastor of the Settleback Church. I've said it a few times. I'm not stealing his thunder. I'm just think it's a good term, and I've said it to you before. The God has never promised us a better life, but he's promised us eternal life. There will be storms in your life and in my life. Is never clear sailing. We know when the Saul in the New Testament had his conversion on the road to Damascus, he was persecuting Christians. He was of the opinion that Jesus was a liar and should be. He was very supportive. He was very glad that Jesus was crucified. And he was trying to stop the new church from developing. And so he was going around putting Christians in jail and probably sometimes killing them. He had a pretty good life. Rome liked him. The Jewish leaders liked him. Everybody liked him except the Christians. And there weren't that many of them around at that time. And Paul was doing pretty well until he had the conversion on the road to Damascus that the Lord met him and he had an experience because Jesus spoke to him. Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? When a voice from heaven comes out at that. you kind of listen. Seems kind of unbelievable to me, don't you think? That seems like, that's hard to believe, and yet Paul, Saul, who became known as Paul, believed it because he heard it. The problem with things that are believable or unbelievable is, the bottom line is this, everything about our life is absolutely, actually unbelievable. If you were to believe that everything in the universe happened by itself, that's completely unbelievable and scientifically unreasonable. The science would be the ones who would always agree that nothing could come out of nothing. Everything can't come out of nothing. Everything had to have a start, and God, if God didn't start it, who started it? But their argument is, well, where did God come from? Well, where did anything come from? It's all unbelievable. Well, you and I are here because of something unbelievable. How would it be possible for there to be nothing? But Paul heard the voice of God, and Jesus spoke to him and said, why do you persecute me? And then Saul, who became the Apostle Paul, didn't have such a good life anymore because he supported the Christian movement. And Paul eventually dies in Rome, probably by being beheaded, because he changed sides and he did not have a very good life as an evangelist. He spent half his life in prison. He wrote half of the New Testament, and much of that New Testament writing was in prison. So that's why I say life isn't necessarily better because you're a Christian. There's aspects of our life that can be better. Habits can change. Lifestyle changes. Those are all good things. But there's no guarantee that I'm going to be all of a sudden freed. I don't have to pay my taxes anymore. Or I'm going to get phone calls saying I've won $19.5 million. I want us to think about a few things. I want to read a little excerpt out of a book I've got by Bill Crowder. I have been a little bit of a follower of Bill Crowder. He's very active in the Daily Bread Ministry. He's a contributor there, and he's a big voice in the organization of it, and he's a very renowned author, speaker, and pastor. But I just picked up this other book recently called A Present Peace, kind of a devotional type, a little booklet. So I was reading this the other day, and I'm just going to read this little paragraph. It's all right. He says, I was quoting him, I was having lunch with a pastor friend when the discussion sadly turned to a mutual friend in ministry who had failed morally. As we grieved together over this fallen comrade, now out of ministry, I wondered aloud, I know anyone can be tempted and anyone can stumble, but he's a smart guy. How can he think he could get away with it? Without blinking, my friend responded, sin makes us stupid. I got thinking about that. Sin makes us stupid. I want us to think about a couple of guys in the Old Testament. A couple of people we'd call heroes. Samson, a tough guy. A judge of Israel, anointed by God, apparently. And he was responsible for protecting the Jews and judging the Jews. But on one of his trips into Gaza, his eyes fall upon a harlot. And she's beautiful, the scripture says. You can find this in Judges 16, if you want to read the story this afternoon. You should read the story. It's quite an entertaining story in a way, but a tragic story. A judge of Israel looks at a prostitute, and she's beautiful, and he falls for her. She's a deceiver. Most of you know the story. She was with the Philistines. That's the enemy of Israel. And Samson was strong. He had an abnormal strength. I don't know what he looked like. He may not have looked muscular because the strength that he had was supernatural, spiritual power that was put on him that he could do things that no one else could do. He could take on armies. He was a superhero. And so her job, Delilah, the harlot, responds to Samson's interest. And he takes her, and they're together, night after night after night. And the Philistines want her to find out information. They want to know, how can we dethrone this guy that's really in the way of us having victory with the Jews? And so, as you know the story, I won't go into detail, but three times Delilah asks Samson, where do you get your strength? And he would lie. Well, if you bind me with chains, I'll become as weak as any other man, or ropes, or brand new ropes, cords, all these things. He said, if you do this, I'll lose my strength. And every time that happens, Delilah calls in the Philistines, the big shots. They come in, and Samson still has the strength. And he wipes them out. Boy, had a good movie that made. I'd love to see enemies go down, you know. He whips them all. But then she continues, Samson, you're lying to me. Really? What are you doing? But that, Samson, you're lying to me. Where do you get your strength from? Finally, he said, the secret is in my hair. If my hair is cut, I will lose my strength. And so she gets the scissors out while he's asleep. She probably got him drunk. Got him, cut his hair. And then the Philistines come in, and he's lost his strength. Now, what happened to Samson? He saw something, his eyes lusted, and he got stupid. Was there anything more stupid of anyone saying, this gal has lied to me three times, maybe this time she won't? I mean, you get the gist of it. It's ridiculous. How could a judge of Israel be that stupid? Let's go to David. David's one of my true heroes in the Bible because it has a good end. We find his story in 2 Samuel chapter 11. I want to read that this afternoon. You're going to have a busy afternoon reading scripture. Otherwise, I'd be here all afternoon talking to you about these stories because there's so much to tell. Think of David. Referred to in the Bible as a man after God's own heart. One day, he was in his palace. It was in the spring of the year. Apparently, that's the season. Did you know there was a season for wars? In the Old Testament, the season of war was in the spring. You go out to beat up each other. So they're at war, and David decided, I'm not going out. Usually the king goes out with his men, but now I'm staying in the palace. He goes out onto the roof of the palace, looking around. What's he doing up there? He's not helping his soldiers. He's not leading his army. He's looking around, and his eye is caught by a beautiful woman bathing in the top of her house. All the roofs were flat. And the palace roof would have been higher than the roof of where he was looking. And he sees a beautiful woman. David, what were you doing up there? What were you doing looking around to see what you could see? So he falls madly in love with this gorgeous woman. You know the story, it's tragic. He gets her brought in, he commits adultery with her. Then he finds she's pregnant. Oh, now what? He already found out that she's the wife of one of the fine army people in his army. And so now what's he going to do? First of all, he's committed adultery, sin against God. And then he decides, you can read the story yourself, then he decides he's going to put her husband, who's out in the army, in the front lines, and he's killed. So he's an adulterer and he's a murderer. What happened to David? This wonderful shepherd boy who was so pure, who writes the 23rd Psalm, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." What happened to his innocent heart? He was up on the palace roof and he starts looking around. That's what happened to David. Looking around, and the devil knew he was up there, and the devil reminded him, "Look over here." And he looks in the wrong place. What happened to David? He was tempted, but he didn't run from the temptation. He could have gone back down to the lower level and got doing some kingly things. Something, surely, whatever kings do when they're not at war, those things, polish up his crown or whatever. But no, he's looking around for a naked woman. He got stupid. Sin makes you stupid. And so we would wonder, why are there so many pastoral people, leaders in the church, have moral failures? Because they get stupid. And any one of us will get stupid if we start looking at the sin. Not all women's fault. We can blame two women for this. I mean, we can blame women in the Garden of Eden too. It was all Eve's fault, right? But we know that Adam was a willing participant in the eating of the fruit. But you can't blame everything on women. Getting a little agreement here from people. Amen. So sometimes, men, we have to stand on our own 2 feet. And we've got to stop looking around. And it's not just women. Believe me, it's all kinds of things. It can be money. It could be fame. It could be more than things than what you and I could even imagine today. The things that we look at that can be tempting for us as men and women, and we make a decision. Am I going to keep looking, or am I going to turn the other way? Whatever it is. So here's why I love the story. It was the prophet Nathan that came to David and confronted him. And Nathan told David a story, a parable. You can find that in that same book, in 2 Samuel. But Nathan said to David, he gives a story, he says, "There was this poor man who had one little ewe lamb that he owned. And then there was this rich man that had thousands in his herds and his flocks. And he went over to the poor man and stole that ewe lamb, butchered it, and had a feast." And Nathan basically said to David, "What do you think of that?" David was angry. "The man should die. He should pay restitution and he should die." And Nathan, the prophet, said, "David, that man is you." And David received it. He wept, and he wrote some psalms. I'm going to close with a few psalms. I'll try to get them in the order that... Before I do that, I just want to read a few more scriptures to show us. So in Hebrews 12, "Therefore, since we have so great a cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us also lay aside every encumbrance of the sin which so easily entangles us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us." Sin entangles us. It makes us stupid. Sin entangled Samson. Sin entangled David. Backing up, sin entangled Adam and Eve. The list goes on. Throughout the Bible, we see sin that entangled people, and sin will entangle us if we let it happen. So, I find what we need to do, it says, fixing our eyes on Jesus. That's how we stop getting entangled up in sin. Fix our eyes on Jesus. And he says, and it goes on, for consider him who has endured such hostility, referring to Jesus, by sinners against himself, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. If we fix our eyes on Jesus, we'll not grow weary and we will not lose heart. So now, in Psalm 51, I want to go to, and here's what David says. Be gracious to me, O God, according to your loving kindness. According to the greatness of your compassion, blot out my transgressions. You see what he's doing here? This is after the sin. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. That's David's repentance. Carrying on in verse 10. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and sustain me with a willing spirit. David bears it all. He tells it for the world, for the whole world to see. And in chapter 32 of Psalms, how blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. How blessed is a man whom the Lord does not impute iniquity, and in those in whose spirit there is no deceit. When I kept silent about my sin, my body wasted away through my groaning all day long, for day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My vitality was drained away as with the fever heat of summer. I acknowledged my sin to you, and my iniquity I did not hide. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. David knew something. He knew that God was not his enemy. David knew that God was his ally. There's a problem in the world, sometimes right in the church. There's a problem with people thinking, when I'm stepping out of my life, when I know I've committed sin, and rather than going to God because he's our ally, God somehow becomes our enemy. Beloved, God is never, ever, ever your enemy. No matter what you have got, he is always your friend. He is always your savior. He is always the one that loves you. David knew this. He knew that God was his ally. Beloved, do we know and remember that God is your ally? He is my ally. He is the one who we go to for help. I want to read one more psalm before I close today. Psalm 18. David says this. You realize all the Psalms are not in necessarily the order which they were written, right? Though 18, not necessarily written before 51 or whatever. Here's what David says. Thank you, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer. My God, my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call upon the Lord who is worthy to be praised, and I am saved from my enemies. God was not his enemy, but he had enemies, and God helped him with his enemies. And he goes on, and then a couple of verses down the road there, he says, in my distress, I called upon the Lord and cried to my God for help. He heard my voice out of his temple, and my cry for help before him came into his ears. Beloved, God's ear is open to you. There may be days when you think nobody else cares a hoot about me. You may think that sometimes. You may know that that's not actually true, but you may feel that. Okay, it's okay if you feel that for a season, but God's ear is open to you because he's not your enemy, he's your ally. He is your friend. As God was indeed David's friend, so he is our friend, and he is our ally. As the lamb cries out to its shepherd, so that it may be found, the shepherd has his ear, listening for the sounds of his lambs. And as the lamb cries out, the shepherd goes to the lamb and restores it to the flock. God's ear is open to you. May God bless us as we participate in the Lord's Supper.
An old word, a new word, tetelestai. Sounds Greek to me, right? It is. And it has been translated many ways. Sometimes it has been translated as the victory is won, or the debt is paid, the mortgage is paid off, etc. But it means it is finished. It was Jesus' word when he was on the cross. But the thought comes, what does it refer to? What does it refer to? Okay. More research has shown that really what it refers to is the work that the Father sent me to do is finished. It is finished. And for that, we can be thankful. Here we are, we're squished in between Canadian Thanksgiving and American Thanksgiving and just before Christmas, and it is finished. We have much to be thankful for. Father, we thank you that indeed it is finished. More than just the idea of a bill being paid or a war being won, you have accomplished all that the Father sent you to do. You have fulfilled all that the prophets have prophesied as to what would be happening, and it is finished. So, Father, this morning, as we take these elements, this bread and this cup, help us to remind us of the body of the Lord Jesus broken on the cross and the blood that was shed for us. And help us to remember that he's coming again. Amen.
Indeed. So Lord Jesus, we thank you for your presence with us today. We thank you for the cross that you went to for us. Lord, as we're reminded of your love, we give you the glory and the praise. We do ask that your hand of wellness we have placed. She wanted to be here today, and we just speak against that mind that she has. And we ask wellness to prevail through her body from her head to her feet. We also pray your blessing on him as he looks for a place in Kamloops to live. And bless his life. And we pray that for all of us, Father. We look here, we know there's issues in our community. Continue to pray for him who's not been well. And we just speak wellness and healing over her. And Dwayne, I see you there coming to church. Most people wouldn't come to church to feel like you're looking. I'll tell you something, God bless you. I just speak God's wellness and his presence to prevail on your life and for you caring for him. And there's other needs that we haven't spoken of today, but Lord, you know them. Would you come and meet those needs, and we would feel your presence in our lives, that we would not be discouraged from crying out to you as a lamb cries out to its shepherd. May we not be discouraged in crying out to you, O God. Bless us and keep us in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless us all. Have a happy, safe week. My love to everybody. Just remember to pray for one another. Thank you. Blessings.